music that's just unbelievable and so different than anything that's around now. Really cool stuff.
Seems like anti-gravity. You know, the idea you can't do this is something his parents didn't teach him, and he just loved being out there playing. That was his life.
In 1959, after Duke Ellington won the highest honor by the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, critics questioned the validity of his receiving an award that had also been given to Martin Luther King Jr. and Daisy Bates, implying that he was not an active enough player in the civil rights movement to win such an award. In response, Duke Ellington said, "They've not been listening to our music. For a long time, social protest and pride in black culture and history have been the most significant themes in what we've done." Although he rarely formally protested or spoke out for civil rights, Duke Ellington made his argument through his music, and in doing so had a huge impact on the nature of segregated America. But who was Duke Ellington?
Duke Ellington was born on April 12, 1899 in Washington, D.C. From a young age, Ellington was surrounded by music. The African American community of D.C. was rich in music and culture for Duke to grab onto. However, Ellington rejected formal training, earning a D in his music class. Instead, Ellington got instruction from musicians he met at the local pool hall. His often overlooked piano skills were shaped by classically trained musicians, as well as ear cats, or musicians who couldn't read a note of music, but learned by ear. It was at the same pool hall that his first band came together.
He wanted to be an artist. He cut school, played a lot of pool. He met his drummer in the pool hall, Sonny Greer. They were together for 50 years. Kind of cool, cool story. And he was just sort of like almost, you know, you can think of it. I mean, a lot of people go, how did he learn this music? He learned it by doing it. He really learned it by doing it. He had some teachers, but it wasn't like he went off to college to study formal composition. He didn't do that at all.
Before the age of 20, Ellington had started both a professional band and a family. Initially, Duke and his bands mostly played covers. It got him gigs and paid the bills, but didn't fulfill him musically. Before long, Ellington started exploring original composition. What came next was a synthesis of all the music he had taken in, all the variety he had been subjected to as a young boy. What came next was jazz.
He was always striving. And do you know what his favorite piece of music was? I'll paraphrase, but I probably have the words pretty close. My Next One. That was his favorite piece of music.
Prior to Duke Ellington, popular music was largely limited to two styles, European harmony and the blues. However, there was little crossover between the audiences of the two genres, with European harmony appealing to a white audience and the blues appealing to a black audience. European harmony, or British brass band, was a formal style of music, largely popular with Europeans, but also with many white Americans. They consisted solely of drums and horns. Coming out of Great Britain, brass bands had roots in the military and the church. As a result, they had strict and rigid musical structures. By the late 19th and early 20th centuries, the style had reached the United States, gaining popularity with a predominantly white audience.
Meanwhile, in New Orleans, two similar styles of music, swing and ragtime, captivated audiences with their soulful and free styles. They were the result of the evolution of the blues, which stemmed from traditional African chants and hymns passed down through slavery. Whereas ragtime was played nearly entirely on the piano, swing was mostly played on a guitar, bass, and a few horns. Despite their differences, the two styles had strong foundations in black communities across America. By 1927, Duke had landed his breakout gig as the leader of the house band at the famed Cotton Club of Harlem. Because of the incredible opportunity he was afforded, Ellington had to look past the racist setting.
He worked at a club called the Cotton Club, which was, as most people now know, was owned by gangsters and had a strict policy of black entertainment for a white audience. and entertainment that was rich in caricature and ugly stereotypes of black people having come from Africa, dress them up in jungle skirts, parade black dancers in front of the musicians, but they're women with the whitest coffee-colored skin, and have the musicians play in a genre what was called jungle music with a jungle beat.
Despite the racial tension, Duke held a newfound position of power. He had his choice of band members and a stage to experiment with his new original composition. Using his impressive horn section, Ellington was told to write jungle music.
And Ellington did this, and this is 1922. This is a different time in America. It's obviously a really rough time for a black artist. And as we say in the business, it's good to have a gig, even if you do compromise.
What Duke gave the audience was a fusion of African-derived swing and ragtime, delivered by the traditional horn section of a brass band.
He had his ear to the ground. He was smart. And he would listen to what's going on. His music is never like this. His music is very open. It's music for the people. You know, people really get it.
Duke used his position at the Cotton Club to catapult his career. Towards the end of his four-year run as leader of the house band, Ellington released his first major hit, Mood Indigo. The radio broadcast of the song garnered praise from all across the country. His newfound fame allowed him to branch out from the Cotton Club and start touring. These opportunities led him across the U.S. and throughout Western Europe. Because his music became so widespread, Duke Ellington, if intentionally or not, taught all different types of people the importance of black culture, and therefore, through his music, lessened the sharp contrast between segregated races and made them more accepting of one another.
In the 1930s, he writes this essay and he concludes with this paragraph saying, "Happy was the day that the first Negro landed on the shores of America. Happy was the day that that first Negro slave, you know, how could you ever say such a thing?" And what he meant, I think, was that look at what came about in America, even though there was this torture, hardship, enslavement, brutality, exploitation, look at what we have. And to him, the great achievement was this music that was only, in his mind, to be considered as the original American music. This was our contribution to the world.
Resiliency of humanity. I don't mean to sound like a high horse here, but imagine this, something is so horrendous, slavery, this music came out. I mean, what else can you think of, like, where subjugation, you know, just torture, horrible lifestyle, and this music came out.
Furthermore, Duke employed anyone and everyone who could play his music, regardless of their external traits, and maintained a completely accepting, encouraging group of different types of people, which was very uncommon at the time.
You know, I've had a really great career. I played with many black bands, some white bands. I never got any feeling of anything from anybody in that band. From Duke on to all the musicians. They just embraced me. White and black musicians, really early on, 40s, maybe earlier, they hung out together. They did things together, jam sessions. I'm not saying every black guy wanted to do this with whites, every one guy wanted to, but with blacks, but they did it. You know, it was like they were ahead of the curve.
What I have to add is this. Go out and listen to some Duke Ellington, and you will be a happy person. Be happy.